We might also call Ming China, which existed from 1368 to 1644, early modern, but for very different reasons than for Japan under Tokugawa rule. The Ming dynasty was, in many ways, reactionary. Its reaction was to the Mongol conquest of China in the immediate past. Chinese developments did involve some modern elements, but in many ways, the Ming dynasty spurred Chinese development toward the modern after the Ming by returning consciously and unconsciously to pre-modern Chinese ideas and policies. Thus, China's early modern period is complex and occurred before that of Japan. During the Ming dynasty, reversion to an agrarian and Confucian way of looking at the world, rejection of trade contacts with continental Asia, and the building of the Great Wall were indicators that the Ming dynasty was making an attempt to return itself to a Chinese view of the world based on the biological world regime. At the same time, however, the building of the world's most high-tech and largest naval fleet, with the capability of navigating the open ocean, participation, for diplomatic purposes, in the Indian Ocean trade, and a reorganization of government were based on modern motivations, not least of which was that the growing population of China was pushing it up against the limits of the biological old regime. Ming history begins with the Mongols. Led by Temujin, Chinggis Khan, born in 1162, Chinggis went from outcast to tribal leader, and by 1206 unified most of the horse-riding nomads in the steppe region that today we call Mongolia. Since he was leader of a tribe called the Mongols, as he conquered other tribes, they took on his tribal name and became Mongols too. Chinggis saw himself as conqueror of the world and set his armies on that path to begin, beginning in 1206. He was working on creating a classic empire, but one whose tribute base was trade rather than agriculture. By the time of Kublai Khan in 1250, the Mongol Empire covered most of Eurasia. It remains the largest land empire in history even today. The horse-borne mobility of Chinggis' armies, their high-tech weaponry, recurve bows for example, and their reputation for cruelty allow them to conquer so much territory despite an army much smaller than those of most of the empires they conquered. In the process, the Mongols conquered China as well. Their focus was trade. The Mongols developed a security system along the Silk Road and employed international banking systems, paper money, and low taxes, along with protection of merchants and tolerance of all religions, to create a profitable trade network along the Silk Road. In the process, they also forced many Chinese manufacturers of the world's most coveted goods, silk cloth and Chinese white porcelain, jade and pepper, to manufacture and sell below the cost of production, thus impoverishing many Chinese. Needless to say, they were less than popular in China. Zhu Yuanzhang, soon to be China's second ever peasant emperor, was born into this chaos. He was the second son in his family, and so not able to inherit anything. He eventually learned to support himself as a beggar, then a Buddhist monk. In the monastery, he taught himself to read and write and began gathering followers. He was a charismatic, pragmatic man who was deeply anti-Mongol. Eventually, he was able to gain enough followers to create a ragtag army and drive the Mongols out of the ancient southern capital of China, Nanjing. Having taken control of Nanjing, he vowed to take all of China back from the Mongols and proclaimed the existence of a new dynasty, the Ming, with himself as its first emperor in 1368. The Mongols, in the midst of a civil war, withdrew from China, and Ming Hongwu was able to reunite China under a Chinese ruler. He had some very specific beliefs. He was anti-gentry. He believed that the Confucian scholars that had assisted emperors since the Han Dynasty could not be trusted, and was angry that some of them had served the Mongols. Still, he also believed that Chinese tradition was what held the state together. So he implemented a reactionary plan to rebuild the Chinese state. Part of that plan was to restore Confucianism as the base of Chinese morality. He then went about rebuilding China's economy on an agrarian rather than a trade basis. He limited trade with the rest of Eurasia. He then restored the Confucian moral economy with peasants as the second most important group in society. He based his taxation system on agriculture and went to great lengths to make sure that farmers paid their taxes in order to do this. He instituted a census system to be administered by Confucian scholars who worked as county magistrates. They had to keep the rolls of people who owned how much land and how much tax they had to pay. To To rebuild the economy further, he encouraged peasants to resettle on land in northern China that had belonged to the Mongols, and gave 5 years of tax-free status to people who began to farm there. He caused 500,000 mulberry trees to be planted to rebuild China's silk industry, and planted hundreds of thousands of other trees for wood to use in building ships and administrative offices. To prevent a Mongol invasion from the north, he rebuilt the Great Wall and extended it, making the wall that tourists see today. Here's a map of China under the Ming Dynasty. It was not as large as China in either the Han or Tang dynasties, but it was more populous, and its economic and agricultural success was such that its population grew dramatically. Here's a picture of one section of the Great Wall as it was rebuilt by the Ming Dynasty. One of the ways in which Ming Hongwu was modern showed up in his reorganization of the Ming government. Here you can see a basic organizational plan. While China remained an empire, the way in which the government was organized reflects both the Confucian idea that government should work along the lines of moral activity and the modern idea that the people have a stake in government. The Ming Dynasty was carefully organized, and government agencies did not stray into each other's territories. Few imperial governments were so well organized before the 19th century. This is impressive, especially when we take into account that the Ming Dynasty had a population of nearly 400 million people by the time it ended in 1644. The third emperor of the Ming Dynasty, Emperor Yongle, who ruled from 1403 to 1424, was the emperor who put the Ming into a turning point. He extended the size of China to include northern Vietnam, retooted Confucian examinations for people who wanted to join the civil service, and he built the Forbidden City. He's also the emperor who caused the great ships to be built that would eventually sail the seven voyages of Zhonghe. This map shows one of China's great modern advances in technology, the seven great voyages that were put together by the Yongle Emperor. They included use of the magnetic compass, the astrolabe, which was borrowed from Arab technology, quadrature charts, and the basic ability to measure distance traveled. These allowed Zhonghe, the admiral that Yongle put in charge of his ships, to sail out of sight of land and into territories that he did not know without getting lost. Chinese fleets with Japanese and Korean merchant ships tagging along regularly reached more than 65 vessels in size and operated in the Indian Ocean, although their mission was diplomatic rather than trade. Zhonghe's ships were huge, more than 450 feet long and 75 feet wide at the beam. They had watertight doors, multiple decks, and large cargo holds. These were the most advanced ships in the world in the period from 1405 to 1433 when they sailed, and even to 1492 when Columbus sailed. Santa Maria was about as long as the distance from the bow to the back of the front cabin on this vessel. Eventually, the Chinese stopped sending these large tribute fleets into the Indian Ocean. Some had gone as far as southern Africa. They probably stopped because, though their mission was diplomatic, some critics claimed that they looked like trading fleets and made the emperor look like a merchant. This was considered immoral, and so the voyages were stopped in 1433 and the vessels allowed to rot at their docks. Emperor Yongle added to the prestige of the Ming Dynasty by building the Forbidden City, a royal palace, inside the Mongol city of Beijing. This became the largest and most opulent palace in the world, signifying the ability of the Ming emperors to combine huge revenues through taxing their subjects. In this way, we can see that the Ming Dynasty still saw itself in terms of the biological old regime, relying on prestige and the organization of an empire. Nonetheless, an empire in and of itself is not necessarily not modern. The Ming emperor's quarters were mostly controlled by eunuchs. These men who had been neutered controlled access to the emperor and were able to gain power because of their control of access to the emperor. Also, the Ming began to fall, partly because of increasingly heavy taxation on what we might think of as a declining tax base. Although the population was growing, in fact, the Ming emperors, whose administrative machinery was not working well, thought that it was declining. So while the Ming dynasty was growing to 150 million by the end of its time, there were only 75 million on the tax rolls by the end of the Ming dynasty. We also see a declining status of women in the Ming dynasty. By 1750, there were 8,600 suicides of widows when their husbands died, versus only 150 suicides in the Song dynasty before the war. The Ming dynasty was thus characterized by inflexibility and conservatism, and tended to react to the Mongols' internationalism and trade orientation by, in fact, closing off China and reverting to traditional or older Chinese-style ways of thinking of things. In this way, the Ming dynasty was essentially pre-modern. In terms of business, the Ming dynasty was far ahead of most of its counterparts in the rest of the world. Business in the Ming was profitable and growing. Conservatism, politically, made a positive business atmosphere because it tended to make taxes over time very predictable. The Confucian focus of the Ming dynasty did also tend to lead to under-taxation of business. And the overpopulation of the Ming dynasty led to an establishment of overseas connections as younger members of Chinese trade families moved overseas in order to make trade connections easier. There's also a great access to the Portuguese and Japan trade during the Ming dynasty. And because of low-cost books due to the invention of printing, there was an information revolution during the Ming dynasty. And in this way, then, the Ming dynasty looks essentially modern. The Ming dynasty was also modern in the sense that it underwent an information revolution. During the Ming dynasty, scholars produced what was known as the Grand Encyclopedia. This was an attempt to bring all knowledge available to the Ming into one great set of volumes, and that set of volumes still exists today in Beijing. Also, the development of some of China's greatest literature, Journey to the West, or Monkey, and Watermark, All Men Are Brothers, these two major books were produced in the Ming Dynasty and are still classics in China today. Wang Yangming, a Confucian scholar, came up with new ways of looking at Confucianism, which involved the ideas of innate knowledge. And then we have painting, including the one that you see on this slide by Tang Yin, and great ceramics, including ceramics that were done using the color Ming blue, which remains famous to this day. The Ming dynasty began to fall apart in large part because of overpopulation, which was ironically undercounted, which, as I mentioned before, led to rising land taxes and a loss of land that was available for use in taxation. Also, secret societies of gentry scholars tended to undercut government policies, and then there was large amounts of inflation, under-taxation, and a kind of a sense of moral bankruptcy among Confucian scholars. The emperors, they thought, were not following Confucian norms, and the Ming dynasty began to gain a reputation for cruelty and overly strict use of law. In 1644, there was also an internal revolt in the Ming Empire. This had to do with criminal gang who had begun to band together and eventually were even able to take Beijing. At the same time, the Jurchen, people who began to call themselves Manchus, had organized themselves in a Chinese way and adopted the Chinese language, and had created a new military organization that made them very, very effective. And they eventually were let through the Great Wall after the bandits took Beijing, and the last Ming emperor committed suicide. And the Manchus then drove out the rebel Chinese, or these bandits, and established the Qing dynasty, which we will look at as a part of your textbook. So, Ming civilization provided a model for organized government, a sense that government should benefit the larger population and not just the rulers, and these two things are quintessentially modern. Seoul is the Ming maritime technology, and their trade innovations and proto-industrial organization, as well as they participated in the modern world market as a market for European New World silver, and this financed much of the exploration and colonization of Europeans of the New World. So in many ways, the Ming Dynasty was modern, just as it was also pre-modern, and this of course qualifies it as an early modern state. China's advanced civilization is really important to understand, and recognizing it is the specialty of scholars like Jonathan Spence, who in the first chapter of his book, In Search of Modern China, makes the point very, very well. He says, quote, rulers in Europe, India, Japan, Russia, and the Ottoman Empire were all struggling to develop systematic bureaucracies that would expand their tax base and manage their swelling territories effectively, as well as to draw new royal power centers the resources of agriculture and trade. But China's massive bureaucracy was already firmly in place, harmonized by a millennium of tradition and bounded by an immense body of statutory laws and provisions that, in theory at least, could offer pertinent advice on any problem that might arise in the daily life of China's people. So where we have been looking to find out what caused the Industrial Revolution in England, specifically, and Europe in general, one of the things that we have been noticing is a trend toward more centralized and efficient government that took fair taxes and supported the economy of its subjects with a clear recognition that their enterprise was good for the national economy, which increased the tax base, which was good for the ruler as well as the people. But as Spence notes, China already had that, and that means we have to take into account 2,300 extra years of history, because the question must then be, why didn't China industrialize? The answer comes, at least in part, in understanding this Ming Dynasty, which ruled China from 1368 to 1644, and the fact that it is really a combination of both pre-modern and modern elements of China. So here's the Ming Dynasty's proto-industrial organization, and you can see that in many ways this looks like what we will look at when we see England and talk about the English putting out system. We have a principal, and the principal's job is to buy thread from people who spin it, and then take it, so the principal will buy the thread, and then he will take the thread to the weaver, and this is all on consignment, so the owner of the thread is the principal. He takes it to the weaver, and on consignment, the weaver turns it into cloth, right? And then the cloth manufacturer will make it into cloth that is usable in various different clothing, etc. And then, again, the principal takes from the cloth manufacturer, pays the contract, and takes to another clothing manufacturer, like a tailor or someone who makes ready-made clothing, and pays them on contract to manufacture clothing, and then the principal will sell the clothing to a retail outlet or create a retail outlet of his own. So in this sense, this whole section, this whole system, looks very much like a factory line system, but it wasn't done in a single building, it was done over relatively large distances, and the principal contracted out to each of these different skilled workers. And these different skilled worker organizations didn't use machines, but they used muscle power and the skills that they had developed themselves. So it is a proto-industrial organization, that is, it doesn't involve machines and new systems of energy, but it is a well-organized system of setting up labor to mass-produce products. China also underwent a cultural revolution during the Ming Dynasty. We see increased literacy, which led to an increased interest in cultural expressions and ideas, and things that are related to culture, including opera, literature, painting, ceramics, and printing, and the degree of different kinds of books that were available in China was unprecedented because of this cultural revolution. China was also the site of Spanish silver convoys, that is, the Spanish would take their silver from South America to the Philippines, and then they would take the silver from the Philippines on a different ship to China, where they would buy silk with the silver. And the Chinese used this silver in their economy. Now, the Ming didn't use coins. They didn't have the ability to control coinage in their realm. So what you see here is one example of a Ming Dynasty tale where unminted silver bar. And these were then sold by weight to get proper coins or to buy other materials. So this was the currency of the Ming Dynasty at the time. So by selling silver to the Chinese in exchange for silk, the Spanish could then take their silk to Japan, which prized Chinese silk very, very much. And Japan also had large silver mines at the time. So the Japanese would buy the silk with silver, and then the Spanish would take the silver back to China, where they would, they would take the silver back to the Philippines, where they would put it on another boat. So by bringing New World silver to China and trading Chinese silk to Japan, and then trading Japanese silver back to Spain, they actually increased their silver take and made quite a large profit. The silver from the New World, though, also flooded the Chinese market, and this caused a devaluation of currency and a recession within the Ming Dynasty, and added to the reasons for Chinese immigration overseas, as well as problems with taxation and prices, etc., for the Chinese government. This also reduced the prices of Chinese goods in Europe and increased interest in Chinese culture and ideas in Europe, so Europeans would begin to be a part of the Asian market. The Ming Dynasty then was both modern and pre-modern in multiple ways. Its organization was an empire, and it was reactionary, preferring agrarian economics to the trade systems established by the Mongols. It created the largest, most high-tech vessels in history at that point, but then stopped using them for reasons of tradition. The Ming emperors were eager participants in the European silver trade, but were unable to gain control over Chinese silver markets well enough to monopolize the minting of their own money, something that any modern state does. China in the Ming Dynasty had a thriving market system and a growing book publishing and culture system, but was also uninterested in trade. Finally, the Ming Dynasty saw major steps toward an early pre-industrial manufacturing system, but did not go further than that in order to develop the industrial systems that would later crop up in Europe. This was probably because the savings on labor was not enough to make the move to industry profitable or tempting to business people. In all of these senses, then, Ming China was early modern. It was both pre-modern and modern. So as you see in the textbook, was the Qing Dynasty that succeeded.